شهر الخير والغفران رمضان 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 May your Ramadan nights be blessed with welfare and forgiveness May your Ramadan nights be blessed with welfare and forgiveness May your Ramadan nights be blessed with welfare and forgiveness May your Ramadan nights be blessed with welfare and forgiveness Ramadan Ramadan Ramadan
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله وكفى وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى لا سيما المصطفى صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا Dear brothers and sisters, welcome to another blessed night. Tonight, alhamdulillah, we're all joined with Sheikh Muhammad Saeed. Thank you for joining us. And Sheikh Ibrahim Zidane, جزاكم الله خيرا كثيرا. And in this blessed night, inshallah, you must have heard the Imam reciting the 18th part of the Quran. In part number 18, it covers the entire chapter of Surah Al-Mu'minun, then Surah Al-Nur, and the first 20 verses of Surah Al-Furqan. Surah Al-Mu'minun and Surah Al-Furqan are both Makki chapters, have been revealed before the migration of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the Meccan era. And Surah Al-Nur was revealed afterward. That's why we will notice that a bunch of teachings and list of commands and prohibitions, because it would suit perfectly the situations in the society of Al-Madinah, which was not available before during the Mecca time. In Surah Al-Mu'minun, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala began the chapter by providing us with the characteristics of the truly successful believers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins the very first verse of Surah Al-Mu'minun by saying, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ Successful indeed are the believers. Then the verses will go on and on explaining the traits and the characteristics of the believers. We would like to begin tackling and studying the sifat and the characteristics of the believers with Sheikh Muhammad Saeed from the beginning of Surah Al-Mu'minun. The first trait is الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, successful indeed are the believers. Number one of their traits, they are خَاشِعُونَ in their prayer. What does it mean to be khashi' in the salah?
Khushu' in salah means showing humbleness, submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is the true fruit of prayer. And it is actually in the top of the good deeds. And the authentic hadith of Abu Amr al-Shaybani, who said, and he pointed to the house of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, and he said, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud narrated to me that he asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam about the best deeds ever. And he said, first, as-salatu ala waqtiha, praying on time. So showing respect to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, submitting to Him, having that fruits of prayers in the heart by showing humbleness and attentiveness and reflection to the prayer, this is the best thing that a person can reap, those glad tidings given to the believers at the beginning of this ayah.
I noticed in this verse there is an extra requirement than the one which is in the hadith that you just mentioned. Because when you say that Allah commanded us to pray, fine. Then Allah commanded us to pray on time. That is the second command. But when you say Allah commanded us to tranquil and have khushu' in the salah, that covers all of the above. Why? Because in order to be khasha, you have first to offer the prayer. And you have to offer it on time. So there is an extra requirement, and that is the top of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala demands from the believers in the salah to be in a state of khushu'. You all know that some of the imams considered al-khushu' of his salah as one of its pillars, one of its arcans. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that one would only receive a reward of his prayer in proportion with the amount of concentration and khushu'. One who was negligent, one who was heedless, daydreaming, that part does not count. The only part of the prayer which a person will be rewarded for, the part which he was attentive in a state in khushu'. It is a concern of every musalli. How can I be in a state of khushu'? I guess before describing the means of acquiring khushu', we have first to describe the state of khushu' itself. How would you define khushu' in a salah, Shaykh Ibrahim?
Alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salam ala Rasulullah. Al khushu' comes from something that is so subtle and something that is so down to earth, if it's correct to say that. Literally, that's what it means. The human being tends to get higher and higher in a state of rebellious against whatever any form of orders. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to be a true servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have to have that state in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have to be servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to humble ourselves to the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the state of khushu' is not just in the salah. It's a state that the believers are in at all times. Because they see themselves as human beings, creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, weak, in need. And they seek help from the Most High, the Most Powerful, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they know that the purpose of our creation is to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone.
So khushu' is submissiveness.
Right. With the humbleness. That the person knows exactly what it means to be a human being. Nothing but the weak creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Some people submit to the will of those who are much more powerful out of fear. But the condition of submissiveness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is entirely different. Because you submit yourself to Allah with a combination of hope and fear. Fear because He is the greatest, He is the most powerful, and that's a command that you have to submit yourself. And hope and love because you know that He really deserved that. And no one else is more worthy of khushu' to be submissive unto Him other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The limbs, our limbs, our body parts are controlled by the King, which is the heart. So those parts, the facial expression for innocence. When you smile, why do you smile? Why do you laugh? Because something have moved your heart with joy and happiness, right? So what makes you cry? Something saddened your heart, right? So I believe the heart is the main source of that khushu'. If the person's heart tranquils, then he would be quiet in his prayer. He would be submissive in his prayer. He will tranquil. If the person's heart comprehend the ayat which he is reciting, if he is the imam or praying by himself, or if he is a follower praying behind an imam, if he comprehends and ponders the meaning of those verses, he would definitely have khushu'. That's why if we would like to advise ourselves or anybody else, Sheikh, how can I gain khushu' in the salah? Work on the heart. If this heart is fully saturated with the love of what diverts your attention from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then no matter how many times you pray, how long you stand in the prayer, you're not attentive because you're not working on the source of khushu', which is the heart. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لا صلاة لحاذق. لا صلاة, there is no prayer for a person who is retaining urine. He has the urge of urination or defecation. Or he is in need to eat. He's starving. And he smells the food being prepared. He cannot concentrate because he's thinking about something that is really possessing his mind and his heart. So in order to enter the salah, one has to work on his heart first. That's why Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith, which is known as Hadith al-Musi'i Salati. When he saw somebody pray, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to that man when he approached him, he said, Arja fasalli fa innaka lam tusalli. This is a companion who offered the prayer. He came to greet the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, go back and pray because you have not prayed yet. So the physical part of the prayer was done, but it was not accepted. Something was missing. He prayed and he returned back. So the Prophet ﷺ repeated the same command. ارجع فصلي فإنك لم تصلي. Go back and pray, you have not prayed yet. And the third time, until finally the man said to the Prophet ﷺ, Ya Rasulullah, teach me. فلا أحسن غير ذلك. I do not know any better. There the Prophet ﷺ explained to him the proper standing, the proper recitation, the proper ruku', the proper sujood, not to hasten in the prayer, not to rush like a rooster picking the seeds from the ground, to tranquil. If the heart tranquils, the body parts were tranquil as well. Sheikh Muhammad, it is really amazing that the second command right after as-salah and being in a state of khushu' in the salah, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنِ اللَّغْوِ مُعْرِضُونَ. And I believe this is also an extra command to being involved in lagh, being a part of it. If you happen to come across lagh or falsehood, you also turn away from it. What do you think of that?
When a person occupies his heart with a lot of attachment to the dunya, a lot of talks, a lot of lies, a lot of listening from here and there, there are a lot of interruptions. So the heart is not well attentive and present in front of Allah, and that's why it is not qualified. Laghu also gives us a hint about talking to people and talking about people and people's affairs. So that's why the scholar said when a person would like to reflect to the Quran and reflect to the meanings of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and shed tears during prayers, he must mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so much. So according to the amount of dhikr that he makes and seclusion to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and dedication of that intention and sincerity to him, it would be surely reflected in his heart. And when tranquility sense in the heart, we make sure that it is a sound receiver of iman, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said هُوَ الَّذِي أَنْزَلَ السَّكِينَةَ فِي قُلُوبِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ لِيَزْدَادُوا إِيمَانًا. So when tranquility comes to the heart, then pleasure about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, rida, a lot of qualities of the believer pours into the heart, and the result of all those qualities, including truthfulness, sincerity, purity of worship, love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, attachment to him, love of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, dhikr to Allah, all of those things will prepare the heart to receive iman. Wonderful. Which is increased. And this iman is very important, because when a person finishes his prayer, one person was asking, what is the solution of all problems of Muslims living nowadays? And he said it lies in prayer. Because when a person perfects his prayer, he would actually could handle everything else. This is the reason when a person receives iman, all the acts of worship would be easy for him. And this is an explanation of the well-known statement of Abdullah al-Bajli when he said, تَعَلَّمْنَا الْإِيمَانَ قَبْلَ الْقُرْآنِ. We learned the iman first. When iman is poured in the heart, all the acts
of worship... Now there is a fertile soil. The Qur'an would drop on it and it would sprout.
Exactly.
Sheikh Ibrahim... whatever we're talking about is written in the tafsir books. And the viewers can easily open the abridged tafsir of Ibn Kathir and read the tafsir. But we're intending to bring into the mind of the viewers the practical applications of what we read and what we learn. For instance, Sheikh Muhammad was talking about the meaning of the turn away from al-lagh. Al-lagh is every vain talk. What is the practical applications to that? How can we tell our youth, our children, our wives who are staying at home most of the time, and ourselves, how to turn away from vain talk? And give examples to some vain talk.
Wallahi, this life that we live in, we either talk, we see things, we hear things. And it's all passages. And it's all passages to the heart. And if we're talking about the khushu' of the heart is like a container. Whatever we fill the heart with, whatever there is, then that the effect will have on the different parts of our bodies. So what are we seeing? What are we listening to? What are we talking about? Then that shows what's in the heart of the human being. We need to stay away from what is haram and to accumulate what is halal. And alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it easy for the believers. The haram is wicked and evil. And we know that with the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's very clear with our sound mind. Vain talk, backbiting. Talking about things that is slandering, for example, or nonsense, or things that would make the heart attached
what
to the worldly.
What about joking while telling lies? For instance, you hear a lot, well, I was just kidding. I was just kidding follows a statement where a person is making up a false story, forging a story. Then the audience almost believe the person is saying, no, I was just kidding. So he says that I was just lying. Did the Prophet said anything in this regard?
He said عليه الصلاة والسلام in the authentic hadith, وَيْلُ اللَّهِ وَيْلُ اللَّهِ وَيْلُ اللَّهِ لِمَنْ كَذَبَ لِيُضْحِكَ النَّاسِ. woe to the person three times, the one that would lie.
In order to make people laugh.
Right.
And he stood surety for something very special for those who give up on lying, even if they were just joking.
Right.
When he said, أَنَا زَعِيمٌ
بَيْتْ فِي رَبَضِ الْجَنَّةِ
Yes.
That the Prophet ﷺ is guaranteeing a house in the outskirts of Jannah for the one that would leave lying.
Wonderful.
And subhanAllah, it's amazing. But then the relation of this with regarding to al-Iman and to the Salah, very briefly, when it comes to outside of the Salah, we need to protect ourselves from what pollutes the heart, sins, and to do the good deeds. Within the Salah, if we are just truthful with whatever we say with our tongue, from the moment we say Allahu Akbar, we mean it. Till we finish the Salah, the khushu' will be there with both things getting together.
I have a very interesting thing to say that I have heard. We're sitting, a group of the greatest shuyukh on earth, we were talking about the concept of khushu'. And each sheikh was saying something, how to acquire khushu'. And one sheikh came up with an ancient saying. The summary of this statement is, what if somebody was watching a movie, listening to music, dating a girl, then he heard the adhan and he rushed to pray. Do you ever think this person who is just involved with this sin, when he says Allahu Akbar, he will simply order khushu', delivery khushu'? Can he ever get khushu'? You brought up this by saying that these body parts absorb things that are passages to the heart. So you saturate your heart with this filth, with the sins. Then when you enter the salah, the king is busy. The heart is completely diverted from paying attention to submissiveness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's thinking about the date. He's thinking about the movie. He's thinking about what you're involved in. And these are some of the adverse effects of committing sins outside the salah. So when you get in the salah, the shaitan will play the game with you, will bring in your inside insight, the views and the pictures of all what you're involved in. So if you want to have khushu' in the salah, that is inseparable from behaving outside the salah as well. We have still the list of the characteristics of the believers, and that will be discussed inshallah after the short break, so stay tuned. Ramadan, Ramadan. Ramadan, Ramadan, Ramadan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We were just chatting before we go online during the break about a very important thing, which is one of the things which helps a lot to attain khushu' in the salah is, for instance, for the brothers who attend the salah in jama'ah, make sure that you leave your home or your business or work to attend the jama'ah a little earlier. Once you hear the adhan, allow some time to enter the masjid before the iqamah, where you get to pray the sunnah and sit. You know, sitting and waiting for the salah brings you into the mood of the prayer. That mood is very, very important. Sheikh Ibrahim was saying, it's like somebody who is running, 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 then all of a sudden he wants to stop. A sudden stop. It's difficult. It is hard. This is what happens when a person keeps himself busy, busy, even with what's lawful. Then he wants to enter the prayer and interrupt all of that. So allowing some time before the salah for the sunnah, walking with tranquility to the prayer, that also helps in acquiring khushu' inshaAllah Azza wa Jal. وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِلزَّكَاةِ فَاعِلُونَ And those who pay their due zakah. وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِفُرُوجِهِمْ حَافِظُونَ إِلَّا عَلَىٰ أَزْوَاجِهِمْ أَوْ مَا مَلَكَتْ أَيْمَانُهُمْ فَإِنَّهُمْ غَيْرُ مَلُومِينَ And those who guard their chastity, guarding the private part means to avoid indulging into an illicit relationship, an outside marriage relationship. لِفُرُوجِهِمْ حَافِظُونَ The word farj refers to the private part of both a man and a woman. It's a very polite word to be said. And furuj, it's plural. Those who guard their chastity through guarding their private parts. How would this be achieved? That's explained in Surah An-Nur, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلِّ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ وَيَحْفَظُوا فُرُوجَهُمْ command the believing men to lower their gaze and guard their private parts. So that will be achieved by preventing the means, blocking the means. Blocking the means which leads to sins. When a person enjoys looking at the beauty of a woman who's not lawful to him, what's expected? Next stage, think about her. Imagine himself being with her. And so on. In many cases, that leads to committing the sin itself. Whether with this woman or with another woman. Because there is a desire like a flame that's lit up in the heart of the person. And if he responds to it, then he indulges into the sin. So, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِفُرُوجِهِمْ حَافِظُونَ That's a quality, the third quality, fourth quality of the successful believers. But they guard the private parts from every woman except their spouses. Similarly, women from their spouses. And the next quality, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِأَمَانَتِهِمْ وَعَادِهِمْ رَعُونَ And give us some explanation to that, Ya Sheikh Ibrahim, with also some practical examples.
Now, those who guard their covenants and their promises, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioning that this is one of the characteristics of the believers. And covenants or promises that we have in our life, there are many. It goes back even to the purpose of our life when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ عَرَضْنَا الْأَمَانَةَ عَلَى السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَالْجِبَالِ فَأَبَيْنَا يَحْمِلْنَاهَا That we have been entrusted. The issue is to whether to obey or to disobey the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a covenant. And we took this covenant when we say, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one that we worship and the only one that we seek help from. So the one that would protect and guard the covenant between himself and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He will be the best person to protect and to guard the covenant between himself
and others
and the rest of the
Even
people.
Even if they're non-Muslims, المؤمنون عند شروطه.
Right.
Once and Allah said in Surah Al-Ma'idah, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَوْفُوا بِالْعُقُودِ Did not specify right. only your contracts with Muslims or relatives or friends. You have a contract with somebody, a lawful contract, you must adhere to its terms.
إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تُؤَدُّوا الْأَمَانَاتِ إِلَى أَهْلِهَا وَإِذَا حَكَمْتُمْ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ أَن تَحْكُمُوا بِالْعَدْلِ Covenant, sometimes people think of contracts as something has to be written. This is not usually the case. Anything, even the word of mouth, this is, can be a form of a contract.
Betraying
or a covenant.
Covenants right. and breaking promises is a sign of hypocrisy, right. as the Prophet
even
ﷺ said.
Muslims or non-Muslims.
Correct. وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَلَى صَلَاتِهِمْ يُحَافِظُونَ Again, he began by talking about the salah. Number one trait, or quality, الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ Those who tranquil and submit themselves in the prayers. Then, the end of these qualities, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَلَى صَلَوَاتِهِمْ يُحَافِظُونَ They guard their prayers. What does it mean? Why are we talking about the prayers again here?
Guarding prayers here means persistently doing them and consistently performing them on time.
In jama'ah. For men, yes.
In masjids. That's why the majority of the scholars said that according to the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ that offering prayers in jama'ah is when it is obligatory. And even the Prophet ﷺ did not give an excuse for the sightless person to leave the jama'ah. And one of the best qualities of keeping a person persistent on the stay on the way of forwardness and straight path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to pray in jama'ah in the first row of prayer, in the first line. That's why somebody was actually, this is a relationship between protecting the private parts and prayer. Somebody told me this story.
إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ
And also there is a practical example of somebody who was betrayed. He committed adultery. And he went to one of the sheikhs and he was complaining how to give up this thing. And he said he is married, but he cannot give up. And then the sheikh told him, just keep maintaining yourself to the first throne prayer. And said, what is the relationship? He said, I'm a businessman, I'm busy, and so on and forth. And he left him. He said, I don't have time. This is the remedy of your disease. And after a while, he came up and he said, I gave up committing fornication or adultery by sticking to the first row in prayer. And subhanAllah, it is a miracle. Because when a person keeps persistently to the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the fruits of prayer are planted in his heart, the seeds or the consequences would actually protecting himself totally from all the sins, from breaking promises and all the qualities mentioned in between the first command, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ أَنْ وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَلَىٰ صَلَوَاتِهِمْ يُحَافِظُونَ
زَكَ اللَّهُ خَيْرًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised the believers in the beginning with success, and by the end he explained what kind of success. After he mentioned the qualities which all of us are invited to adopt, he said, أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْوَارِثُونَ, they are the true heirs. Would inherit what? The inheritors of what? الَّذِينَ يَرِثُونَ الْفِرْدَوْسَ هُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ. Al-Firdaus, brothers and sisters, isn't just paradise. It is the topmost part of heaven. The Prophet ﷺ said, you should have a very high zeal. You should be very ambitious when it comes to asking for salvation and enter in heaven. You should not just settle for the basement of heaven. Or just to enter heaven, as some say, I don't really mind how would I enter it from the window, from the door, as long as I get saved. Rather, he said, إِذَا سَأَلْتُمُ اللَّهَ فَاسْأَلُوهُ الْفِرْدَوْسَ الْأَعْلَى. The highest, the peak of paradise, the core of heaven is Al-Firdaus. So those who adopt these qualities will inherit Al-Firdaus, هُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ, they shall reside therein eternally. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us all among them, where we get to speak about those qualities of the believers that we discussed in the dunya. Sheikh Ibrahim, the next tab we have is in verse number 51. يا أيها الرسل كلوا من الطيبات واعملوا صالحا إني بما تعملون عليم. O the messengers of Allah, eat from الطيبات, from what's good. And what's good is love. يحل لهم الطيبات ويحرم عليهم الخبائث. قل أحل لكم الطيبات واعملوا صالحا, and do righteous deeds, because I'm fully aware with what you do. What is the relationship between eating from halal and doing good righteous deeds?
Eating from halal and doing good righteous deeds is basically the same thing, because they're all good deeds and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to perform them. And for a person to eat what is lawful, that would make the dua of the person accepted. That won't make the person rejected. And as a result of that, the good deeds will be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
And also, in order to eat lawfully, you have to earn it lawfully, right?
And the Prophet ﷺ, he said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the people or the believers with what he ordered the messengers. Because in the Quran it says, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ كُلُوا مِمَّا فِي الْأَرْضِ حَلَالًا طَيِّبًا وَكُلُوا مِنْ طَيِّبَاتِ مَا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ, that for the people, for the mankind, also to eat from what is lawful. And the Prophet ﷺ warned us that a person might do the righteous good deeds. And even mentioned the example of a man that is with uncombed hair, and he is Ash'ath Akhbar, and he is going in a traveler, traveling for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It was said like something for Hajj or something of that nature. And he's raising his hand to make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, took the means for the dua to be accepted. But his feeding or his food is from haram, his drink is from haram, and his nutrition is from haram.
He's so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, from haram.
Nah. No. And he said, أَنَّ يُسْتَجَبُ لَهُ, that he is far away from the acceptance of the dua. So if a person wants to have the dua accepted, a person wants to have the help and the blessings to do righteous good deeds, we need to make sure that we know what we earn our money from halal, and we also spend it in what's permissible and lawful for us.
Jazakallah khairan. Verse 57 through verse number 61 speak about what I like most, the combination of hope and fear, and explains the nature of worship in Islam. Many non-Muslims and some Muslims who happen to be unaware of Islam, seculars, liberals, you name it, they look into the practice of Muslims as, what's wrong with these guys? Why they're so keen to pray, and meanwhile they're always afraid. They say the Quran always talks about that Allah is all forgiving, Allah is merciful, Allah will forgive sins. Correct. But they don't see the other part of the story. They don't see the rest of the verse, which is, اعلموا أن الله شديد العقاب وأن الله غفور رحيم. Get to know that Allah is severe in punishment, and He is also all forgiving, and He is most merciful. So the ayah 57 says, Ya Shaykh Muhammad, إن الذين هم من خشية ربهم مشفقون. First quality. Second, والذين هم بآيات ربهم يؤمنون. The third quality. والذين هم بربهم لا يشركون. Then take this. والذين يؤتون ما آتوا وقلوبهم وجلة أنهم إلى ربهم راجعون. These traits describing whom? Is this describing the sinners, the believers who are religiously committed, or who exactly?
Sayyida Aisha radiallahu anha, may Allah be pleased with her, the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, asked him this question.
About the last verse, وَالَّذِينَ يُؤْتُونَ مَا آتَوْا.
Exactly. She is asking about the target audience of this verse. She is saying, are they the people who commit adultery and fornication and steal and they commit sins and then they repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Or who are the target audience of this verse? And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, they are the dedicated servants of Allah who do their best and their utmost. But at the same time, they are afraid whether Allah has accepted their deeds or not. A sense of deficiency, a sense of imperfection, and a sense of need for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept. And also a sense of confession and admitting that Allah is the source of all mercy. And Allah is the source of all good deeds that He presented for us.
So I guess we also need to give the viewers the meaning of this last verse. وَالَّذِينَ يُؤْتُونَ مَا أَتَوْا وَقُلُوبُهُمْ أَجِلَةً. They give whatever they give in a charity, or they do whatever they do of any good deed, you name it, prayers, fasting, going for hajj. You know how delighted we get when we get to perform hajj, and some people say, this is my seventh hajj. I performed hajj 10 times. Or they brag about their good deeds and so on. The true believers, they give whatever they give. They do whatever they do. And they have this combination of hope that Allah will accept their good deed and fear that it might not be accepted. They might not be rewarded for it. وَقُلُوبُهُمْ وَجِلَةً. While their hearts are full of fear. That's why Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha ardaha, right away, as any ordinary audience, thought, this ayah is talking about the sinners, the big sinners. They're afraid that Allah will not accept from them because they were indulged into major sins. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, no, it is those who do the good deeds and they're afraid that it might not be accepted from them. Why? أَنَّهُمْ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ
رَجَعُونَ. And also, when they contemplate on the perfection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the great mercy that Allah showered upon them. That's why the scholar said, وَلَا يَتِمُّ الْعَمَلِ إِلَّا بِنُقْصَانِ ذَلِكَ عِنْدَهِ. Yani, a deed cannot be perfect unless a person has a deep feeling that it is imperfect.
Yeah, he did not this really do reason, enough.
This is the reason when we finish prayer, the first thing that we say is, أستغفرullah. Astaghfirullah. Why you seek Allah's forgiveness? Because the type of prayer that you offer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not qualified.
And this command, Shaykh Muhammad, is after every ibadah in Hajj. فَإِذَا قَضَيْتُم مَنَاسِكَكُمْ
فَاذْكُرُوا اللَّهِ.
Remember Allah by seeking forgiveness, by glorifying Allah in order to complete any imperfection that took place in same in siyam, in giving sadaqah and so on. Jazakallahu khayran. There is only 1 minute left before we take the next break. This ayah requires some reflection. مَتَّخَذَ اللَّهُ مِنْ وَلَدٍ وَمَا كَانَ مَعْهُ مِنْ إِلَهٍ. Initially we agreed, Sheikh Muhammad will be speaking about it, but it requires all of us to get involved in its interpretation. Verse number 91 of Surah Al-Mu'minun. مَتَّخَذَ اللَّهُ مِنْ وَلَدٍ وَمَا كَانَ مَعْهُ مِنْ إِلَهٍ. Allah did not take a son. He begets not, nor was he begotten. And there is no God besides him, then he will turn to give the logical explanation, which is, إِذَا لَذَهَبَ كُلُّ إِلَٰهٍ بِمَا خَلَقٍ وَلَعَلَىٰ بَعْضُهُمْ عَلَىٰ بَعْضٍ. Sheikh Ibrahim?
This verse is a mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Most High, He is in no need to convince people. It is enough for the revelation to come and for the people to be ordered to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. But see how the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is addressing the logic, the minds of people, the intellect of the human beings, that how can they believe that there is more than one to be worshipped on the face of earth? If they are, then each God will rule according to his own will and so on.
Sheikh Ibrahim, that to be continued inshallah after the break. So brothers and sisters, stay tuned. Inshallah, we'll be back in just a couple of minutes.
Ramadan.
O you who believe, observing the fast is prescribed for you as it was prescribed for those before you, that you may become pious.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh and welcome back. Talking about how does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reason and proves via logical means that there is not and there could not be any God besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no creator besides Him. I remember whenever we visit Europe or some of those countries where the steering wheel is to the right. Every time I try to get in the car, I sit in the driver's seat because I'm not the driver anyway, so I sit in the driver's seat. So it crosses my mind, what if there are two steering wheels and two drivers for the same vehicle? What will happen? Let's say we came at an intersection. I decided to make right, and he decided to take left. What may happen?
They would have to design the car that somebody has to be shut down.
Split, right?
Otherwise, the
exactly. Work. There's got to be one driver,
right?
One controller.
Right.
And this is for a vehicle that does not even appear on the map.
Right.
Imagine we're talking about this magnificent universe and how the Romans and the Greeks, they believe there are different gods, God for this and God for that and God for the wind and God for the rain and God for love and God for hate. So one God likes this man and the other has a problem with him. Now I don't want him to live. And the other God, no, I want him to live. I like him. And they fight over this, like you see in old movies and about the Romans and so on. What will happen? A chaos. That's why there is another verse in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَوْ كَانَ فِيهِمَا آلِهَةٌ إِلَّا اللَّهُ لَفَسَدَتَ. If there has been more than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as an ilah, then they would have been ruined, the heavens and the earth. One does not want sun to rise today. And the other says, no, sun has to rise today. So it's either one of two. They fight and one would overcome the other and there will be only one. Okay? Or they fight and they destroy the earth and we will not exist. But the fact that everything is steady and in a perfect system indicates that there is only one controller, one creator, one sustainer, one ilah. That is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Please, Sheikh Ibrahim.
And the same thing with regarding to one of the things that people are busy with nowadays, matters of ruling.
Mm.
You know, إِنِ الْحُكْمُ إِلَّا لِلَّهِ. And you would see that in the Quran in many verses,
mm,
that when it comes to the obedience to Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But when it comes to the hudud and the boundaries, it's only the boundaries of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
أَلَا يَعْلَمُ مَنْ خَلَقَ وَهُوَ اللَّطِيفُ الْخَبِيرُ
أَلَا لَهُ الْخَلْقُ وَالْأَمْرُ. He's the only creator, so He's the only one that the orders is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He's the only one to be worshipped, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why the ease and the mercy in the deen of Islam, that everything would make sense, that every human being, no matter what type of a person that is, it's ordering the people to have this clear understanding and belief that the only one worthy of worship is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
So why, Shaykh Muhammad, that some people reject anything that is relating to the ruling of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Once they know that it is Sharia, they're allergic to that word, to the term Sharia. Even if it is for the best of humanity, when you examine the human rights resolution, you will find that most of its articles are actually stemming from the human rights rules and regulations in the Quran and in the Sunnah. And some of them are not perfect because they are not in line with the guidance of the Quran and the Sunnah. We have discussed this before in details. So those who do not accept the ruling of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yet when any of us, including them, buy for instance an iPhone and anything goes bad with it. The touch screen is not working, something is not functioning properly. Where do we take it to be fixed?
For sure, for the original manufacturer or even according to the catalog itself.
But we don't try to make an attempt to fix it on our own?
Exactly. Otherwise, we will...
Not take it to a mechanic?
Exactly. Because you asked about the reasons, and I think that there are two reasons. Number one, there is imperfect belief. Mm. People reject the commands of Allah because of imperfect belief. Mm. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that in the Quran, فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِيمَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ. So there is no belief if we just restrict ourselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just within the masjids, only for prayers. And this is a secular attitude. People believe that Allah only lies in masjids and reading Quran, whatever we do. But when we go outside, it doesn't have to do anything in our daily life.
Islam, there is no distinction, no difference between what's worldly and what's religious. Everything belongs to Allah.
Exactly. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِي لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Say my prayers, my sacrifice, and my life and death, my health and wealth and everything in the life is mainly dedicated for Allah.
By the way, whether you like it or not, this is that's a fact. Exactly. So those who reject this and say, that's my life, I'm free to do whatever I want to do, and by that he believes that himself, he can do whatever he wishes because he thinks it is right, but he's still within certain limit, that he cannot cross those boundaries. He cannot, for instance, everybody likes to be a millionaire, okay? Somebody is trying his best to be a millionaire, but it is not ordained for you to be a millionaire. You're going to keep a poor-unaire as long as that is the key for you.
And the second reason is a lack of sense, of common sense. Because when we watch the whole universe and we look at the earth and the heavens and everything, we see a secret and a persistent and consistent harmony over there. In every single being that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created, everything goes in harmony and in amazing system that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created. We cannot find conflict, controversies. We cannot find any opposition. This is the reason. It means that the whole universe, which is consistent, is created by only one God, which is Lord.
Sheikh Ibrahim, did you ever get in a fight? Fist fight?
I did long time ago.
Not anymore.
No, when I was
Sheikh Muhammad, have you?
No, alhamdulillah.
Okay, I was in Karate, so we were into that pretty much. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us a divine way of sorting such problems and conflicts. We tried both ways. We tried fist fighting. We tried taking revenge. And we tried this way. And I swear, wallahi, by all means, even away from this is the religious ruling and educations and all of that, that what gives you comfort and peace of mind and happiness is this. ادفع بالتي هي أحسن السيئة فإذا الذي بينك وبينه عداوة كأنه ولي حميم. Humanity nowadays does not know this law. They do not understand it. They're not willing even to yield to this fact. Repel the evil with what's good. Then the result will be that one who was your greatest enemy will become an intimate friend. Right? Do you have to say anything on that?
This is in the nature of the human beings. If somebody would show kindness to you, he basically make you or put you in chains, actually. You know, that you're all of a sudden, you have to be nice. Unless a person is evil,
this captures you.
Right, definitely. So imagine that a person is done something evil to you, he expects that you would retaliate with the same thing. But instead, you would return with a smile. What would be the reaction of this person? I would advise myself and others, try it on a lower standard, like in driving, for example. Right? Something happens, and the person did something to you that is, you know, said bad word or whatever, and instead look at him and smile. It won't hurt you anything because after a minute, everything's finished. Look at him and smile and see the reaction. It's amazing. And you would see the truthfulness of the verse, which is in the nature of the human being. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful, And we are called to use our minds and to put it in practice. And this is something that we would
say. Other ayah which I quoted in the beginning, ادفع بالتي أحسن فعل the evil with one which is good. فإذا الذي بينك وبينه عداوة كأنه ولي حميم, talks about every person. If you try this, you treat the one who addresses you with foolishness, with a better way, like pardoning, for instance, not reacting, and that will bring the thought in the mind of your opponent that why this guy is better than me, or he's being good to me, that I should be good to him. In this ayah, the Prophet ﷺ was addressed, ادفع بالتي هي أحسن السيئة نحن أعلم بما يصفون. So he was actually addressed to deal with even the non-believers with one which is best. Meet and repel their evil with one which is best. He says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are best acquainted with the things that they utter and they say.
And that's why, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has heard in the verse, that we need to look of what is benefiting to us, and we have to have the heart attached to the hereafter.
You know, there was a woman, an older woman, who was carrying a heavy load. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was well-mannered before Islam and after Islam, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prepared him for this mission. And he saw this older woman carrying the heavy load, so he rushed to assist her, and he carried her load for her. All the way to her final destination. The woman could not afford to reward them. She said, well, I can only do one thing because I cannot pay you enough for what you did to me. But I would like to warn you again, it's a man who misleads people in town. His name is Muhammad. Be careful. Don't you ever listen to him. I just can imagine the scene when the Prophet ﷺ listens to her carefully. Then after she finishes, he says, Ummah, ma'am, my mother, I am Muhammad. And the reaction of this woman who was warning him against what she did not know anything about him but the rumors that he's a madman, he's a sorcerer. Now she gets to know that this man with the best manners is nothing but Muhammad, whom she was warning him against. Then she accepts Islam because of this way. وَقُلْ رَبِّ أَعُوذُ بِكَ مِنْ هَمَزَاتِ الشَّيَاطِينُ وَأَعُوذُ بِكَ رَبِّ أَنْ يَحْضُرُونَ حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءَ أَحَدَهُمُ الْمَوْتُ قَالَ رَبِّ ارْجِعُونَ لَعَلِّي أَعْمَلُ صَالِحًا فِيمَا تَرَكْتَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the fate of the non-believers, non-Muslims, the criminals who are lousy, who are negligent of Allah's rights upon them, until it is their death time. Lying on their deathbed, they witness the signs of death. They see the angels of death surrounding them, waiting for the angel of death to take his soul. Then they say, رَبِّ ارْجِعُونَ, give me a respite, give me another chance, in order to do some good deeds in the remaining part of my life.
But there is no return, because the test is over. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave his judgment that once the agonies of this strikes a person, he now moved from the world of what is commonly the physical world into the world of shahada, or the hereafter was unseen for him before, and now it became something real fact, so there is no return.
And
this
also
is the reason the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that, and he explained at the agonies of this, there is no way of repentance and returning back. But before this point, a person can
Tawbah repent. May be accepted. And this ayah also, Shaykh Ibrahim, tells us about the intermediate life. There is this short and brief life, then there is Hayatul Barzakh. And we knew that its name is Al-Barzakh from this ayah. Kalla, إِنَّهَا كَلِمَةٌ هُوَ قَائِلُهَا. It's just mere wishes that he will be returned or be extended in his life or given a respite. وَمِنْ وَرَائِهِمْ بَرْزَخٌ إِلَىٰ يَوْمِ يُبْعَثُونَ. The next life is the intermediate life, life in the grave, where we believe, and this is a part of the belief of Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, that there is a life in the grave, whether similar to life in heaven or hell, based on the actual fate of the person afterward. That's why we believe in what's known as عذاب القبر ونعيم. There is a torment in the grave for the disbelievers and the criminals, and there is a joy and delight in the grave for the believers. إلى يوم يبعثون. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Ghafir about the fellow, النار يعرضون عليها غدوا وعشيا ويوم تقوم الساعة أدخلوا آل فرعون أشد العذاب. So the Pharaoh and his people, even though they were drowned, but they are being tortured and punished all the time and every day and every night until the day of judgment. That's Hayatul Barzakh in torment. Then on the day of judgment, وَيَوْمَ تَقُومُ السَّاعَةُ, on the day of resurrection, admit the Pharaoh and his troops and his family and his assistants into the worst of punishment. وَلَعَيَذُ بَاللَّهِ. I would like to end up with Sheikh Ibrahim giving us some insight in less than 1 minute, in 30 seconds. On that verse, verse number 21 of Surah An-Nur, the light, it's a Madani Surah. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَتَّبِعُوا خُطُوَاتِ الشَّيْطَانِ وَمَنْ يَتَّبِعُ خُطُوَاتِ الشَّيْطَانِ فَإِنَّهُ يَأْمُرُ بِالْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, oh, you believe, don't you follow the footsteps of a shaytan. In order to talk about the footsteps, you have to see who's walking. Do we ever see the shaytan, let alone seeing his footsteps?
No, of course not. And this is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, that the shaytan has a superior nature on us with regarding to one aspect, and that is إِنَّهُ يَرَاكُمْ هُوَ قَبِيرٌ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا تَرَنَهُمْ. He sees us, but we can't see him. That's why the shaytan, he does not come to the believers and tell the believers to commit zina or to drink wine and so on, because he knows that this will be rejected.
He gradually withdraws them.
Right, one step after another. And even the ulama, they mention these steps, and it goes from being, imagine someone very righteous, goes to be busy with what is mubah, what is permissible too much, and then to the level of the minor sins and major sins, then innovations in the religion, then shirk, and then a person all of a sudden he finds out, he wakes up when he's been dragged down without making sure that he corrects himself. So the warning is not from listening to the shaitan, all of a sudden it's the trap of the shaitan that takes the person step after.
Allah khairan, may Allah protect us all against Satan and his plans and his traps. May Allah make us most powerful to defeat the shaitan and avoid his whispers. May Allah protect us and guide us what's best. Sheikh Muhammad and Sheikh Ibrahim, thank you so much for joining us. And until another blessed night, brothers and sisters, I leave you in the care of Allah. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
طابت لياليكم بشهر الخير والغفران. 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 رمضان 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 رمضان. May your Ramadan nights be blessed with welfare and forgiveness. May your Ramadan nights be blessed with welfare and forgiveness. May your Ramadan nights be blessed with welfare and forgiveness. May your Ramadan nights be blessed with welfare and forgiveness. Ramadan, 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 Ramadan.